Gulf of Naples, cradle of European culture, situated in the south of Italy. Favored by the gods, art and culture combine to delight we mere mortals. Naples marks the beginning of a dream journey. A city that gave its name to the Gulf and its famous islands. The Centro Storico Monumentale is situated at the harbor, with the large piazza del Plebiscito and the Triumph Church that was built following the return of the Bourbons, modeled on the Pantheon of Rome. Opposite the Palazzo Reale is an external facade and niches that contain the statues of eight past rulers of Naples. On the corner of the square is the Café Gambrinus. Next, the Galleria Umberto Mall. And closer to the harbour, the mighty Castelnuovo. In the 14th century, both political and cultural life took place here. Borgo Santa Lucia lies in front of the city. The island is dominated by a building which in ancient times was the residence of Lucullus, the Castel dell'Ovo, the oldest fortress in Naples. On the Caracciolo coastal road towards Mergellina is the Parco Comunale. This former royal garden boasts the oldest aquarium and marine research institute in Europe. And at various weekends, a flea market takes place in the park. The promenade ends in Mergellina. We enter through Porta Capuano, Europe's largest ancient town. The Centro Storico Antico, a fine world of both myth and reality. On the Via dei Tribunali, the lifeline of the city, the Gothic Duomo di San Gennaro was built in 1400. With paradise frescoes on the cappella, and the oldest baptistry in the Occident. A small side street, the Via Gregorio Ameno, is known as the Alley of the Christmas Cribs. Almost completely hidden within a maze of streets is the greatest Neapolitan convent of the Franciscan order, including some amazing archaeology. Where once stood the ancient Agora of Napoli, St. Cayetan invites us to visit the early Baroque basilica that was named after him. He lies in a sarcophagus in the crypt. Santa Chiara appears to be plain and severe, but its courtyard and cloisters are decorated with beautiful majolicas. The ancient town ends at the Piazza Gesù Nuovo. At the highest point of the city mound of Vomero is the spectacular Castel Sant'Elmo with its amazing views. A mighty structure. Here also is the former Carthusian monastery of San Martino. Napoli, the city below Vesuvius. Early in the morning, the first ferries bring passengers, goods, and vehicles to various islands in the Gulf of Naples. First, the Isola di Procida. we slowly approached the small harbor. Measuring 4 square kilometers, Procida is the smallest island off Naples, densely populated and with a long history. The site of the picturesque Marina Grande at the Cattolico ferry port typifies relaxed island life. Religious seamen built churches and houses here, up steep slopes to the old town of Terra Murata, the walled country. Fishing combines with tourism, and the region's boat building and marine skills had their roots here. The buildings are unmistakably Arabian in character, with arches, balconies, external stairways, and semicircular windows. The road leads up to the old town through narrow streets. Halfway up and located between the houses is the Baroque Santa Maria della Grazia Church. From here, the view of the fishing village of Coricera is quite remarkable, with its small harbor and colorful buildings situated on the caldera of an extinct volcano. What now looks peaceful and romantic has a dramatic history. The area around the castle is like a sleepy and mysterious scene from another age. Closely packed together, a mosaic of citadel, palace, monastery, and numerous buildings. On tough rock at 90 meters above sea level. Terra Murata was built in the 16th century under Alfonso of Avalos, who made Castle Hill secure in order to protect the islanders from pirate raids. Here too, the architecture of the buildings in the narrow streets is of Arabian design. The subsequent hunting grounds of the Bourbons became an island prison, and eventually the leisure time destination of the inhabitants of Naples. The ferry leaves the port and travels along the coast once again past the fort to the next island, where today ferries travel to and fro was once a crater lake that flowed into the sea. Ischia, the island of Titan Tifoios, the largest of the three islands in the Gulf of Naples, each one now being a popular tourist destination. Situated on the fortified quay, colorful buildings welcome visitors. Both Ischia Porto and Ischia Ponte appear to have developed together. Here there are modest houses, the palazzi of the rich, and fine Baroque churches. The village of Ponte is still home to fishermen who offer their tasty daily catch on the pier. Castello Aragonese is the symbol of Ischia, a small town protected by the castle situated on a rock just off the island. The ruins of the castle, settlement, churches, and monasteries feature numerous architectural styles. The village is connected to the little island by a causeway. Here the sea still affects daily routine, and life on the coast between Ponte and Porto has remained unchanged. A picture postcard idyll. Ischia's wide streets and vibrant waterfront reveal a popular tourist destination, and excursion boats are moored in front of typical harbourside restaurants. The Isola Verde is rightly known as the Green Island. In addition to its hot springs, the lush vegetation is a splendid sight. Cliff walls plunge steeply to the sea, and settlements nestle on each spare plot of land. Magical fishing villages such as Sant'Angelo enchant with their white and pastel-coloured Moorish buildings, crowded together close to the volcanic cliffs. The picturesque scenery of the south. Forio, the second largest community on the island, is a centre of the wine trade. When the sun sets behind the picturesque church on the rock, all is at peace. Back on the mainland, an impressive mountain awaits us in Naples. Vesuvius, a place of ancient myth and catastrophe. A bizarre landscape of craters with mysterious wisps of smoke. Since early times, an active volcano that last erupted in 1944. Its highly explosive potential and nearby large population make Vesuvius the most dangerous volcanic threat in Europe. It was here that the world's first well-documented natural disaster took place. Pompeii. The incarnation of a civilization that was destroyed by natural forces. And it was only by accident that parts of the ancient city were discovered south of Naples. Numerous underground corridors which contained statues and inscriptions were discovered during work on the drainage system in 1594. At that time, no one suspected that these discoveries were part of an ancient city. The scientific excavations that continue to the present day began in the 18th century. More than a third of the city is still concealed beneath the volcanic rock. Due to the airtight conditions beneath the lava, Pompeii is the best preserved ancient city in the world. Entire streets and buildings are still in excellent condition. The lively city of Pompeii attempted to compete with Rome and offered its visitors and guests abundant luxury and diverse entertainment. Various buildings and baths highlight the advanced civilization of that time. And a large theater with its magnificent colonnades competed with the temples of numerous gods. But the prosperity of this city, which was located at the foot of Vesuvius, came to a sudden and tragic end. On August the 24th, 79 AD, a massive volcanic eruption destroyed the city. Millions of tons of lava, pumice stone and ash shot up into the sky. A black cloud, several kilometers high, moved towards the city, covering it with lava, fumes and ash. The ancient city lay buried among ash and lava for almost 1,500 years. Castellammare is the hectic gateway to the mountainous peninsula of Sorrento. The ancient name of the city was Stabiae. The devastating eruption of Vesuvius also buried this Roman settlement beneath a meter of ash. There's a promenade along the curved harbour bay. A small fishing pier is squeezed between the ferry terminal and giant shipyards. This mix of resort and industrial centre dates back to Ferdinand IV, who designed the shipyards in 1785. Where once visitors walked in a peaceful atmosphere, hustle and bustle eventually conquered the ancient streets and squares. Life here is hectic. The city centre has been pedestrianised, and the cathedral and many of the old buildings have been well preserved in all of their original splendour. The former wealth of this city is struggling with modern demands. Sorrento marks the beginning of a journey along the most beautiful panoramic roads in the world, the Amalfitana. This small town is located in an expansive bay and extends on a cliff above the sea with turn-of-the-century villas and grand hotels. A number of Britain's wealthy have recently discovered this place for themselves, a popular location at the southern end of the Gulf of Naples. Formerly a Greek settlement and birthplace of Torquato Tasso, Sorrento's secrets lie hidden in numerous cloisters, gardens and courtyards, and within the footsteps of European history. They all came here, Greeks, Romans, Normans, French and Spanish, to a place that since ancient times has been used for recreation. Most of the streets are typical of Roman city planning, and the San Francesco Cathedral is located on the site of an ancient forum. The attached cloister of the former Franciscan convent is of Gothic Moorish design. In the 18th and 19th centuries, wealthy Central and Northern Europeans discovered the scenic beauty, mild climate, and hospitality of this region. World-famous hotels were built, and it soon attracted the stars of stage and screen. The old town has retained the atmosphere of bygone times. Where once Benedictines and Franciscans went about their holy duties, the holiday feeling is now celebrated in a splendid environment with all the Mediterranean flair that goes with it, including historic and picturesque towns. Sorrento is famous for its music, so a visit to the Teatro Tasso is one of the highlights of our visit, as it's where the Sorrento Musicale is performed each night. There are songs and dances of the sea and the marketplace. The main theme is love. Which is expressed by well-known songs. Yeah. During the final public festival, the fiery tarantella is danced late into the evening. Hundred years of traditional music, dance and customs captivate the audience. Early in the morning, the ferry leaves the port of Sorrento. Our route goes south along the Gulf of Sorrento to the third and most famous island in the Tyrrhenian Sea. Capri, a magical place, the quintessence of romance, a dream that reawakes each day. The Marina Grande welcomes us. Colorful buildings with balconies and terraces, shops and restaurants, and many small boats. Capri Village attracts many visitors. And a funicolare makes the going easy. The views are truly outstanding. Capri Village, with its small main square, the Salon of Europe, is an enchanting location set within a striking, rocky landscape. The Baroque church with its adjoining bell tower is a main symbol of the island. And the nearby Kisisana is one of the most luxurious hotels in the world. Beyond the maze of lanes, there's a huge monastery complex, the Certosa di San Giacomo. At the end of the 14th century, this former Carthusian monastery was built according to the design of the Charterhouse of Naples. Above the Certosa, at the highest point of the Via Matteotti, is a small park that was commissioned by Krupp, the famous German industrialist. Capri is both tourism and idyll. Anna Capri is the second capital of the island. Its oldest area, Le Bouffay, contains narrow streets, extravagant buildings, and tiny squares. Here it is quieter and less built up, more natural. The forecourt of the Baroque Church of Santa Sofia is the meeting place of the locals who are little affected by tourism. However, popular with tourists and in a superb location on the edge of a cliff, is the Villa San Michele. This was once the home and workplace of Swedish physician, collector and writer Axel Munthe, who here realized his dream of a white villa. A free-of-charge chairlift travels up the green northern slopes of Monte Solaro, the highest mountain on the island. Here, La Dolce Vita and tourism seem far away. And Capri is like a distant magic land set within an azure sea. Vibrant cities, amazing islands, and a paradise of nature and ancient worlds, all harmoniously united on the coast of light, in the captivating Gulf of Naples.